Hi again, and welcome to another video. In this one, I'll cover the 14-inch version of the Lenovo IdeaPad Slim 3 Gen 8. During the video, we'll take a good look at the physical characteristics of the device and its specifications, and of course, I'll also perform some benchmarks to see how it will perform. This laptop is, as the name suggests, part of the IdeaPad range of Lenovo, which is a non-professional line of laptops that's not targeted to gaming. As you can see, there are a few different variants available, mainly differencing in either screen size, 16-inch, 15-inch, or like this one, 14-inch, and each of these comes in an Intel and an AMD Ryzen variant. The exact model that we'll look at today is the 14AMN8, which is equipped with an AMD Ryzen 7520U, 16GB of DDR5 memory, and a 512GB NVMe SSD. Except for the performance, of course, and maybe thermals and cooling, all the physical aspects that I'll be covering should also be applicable to the Intel variant of this machine. At first glance, this laptop feels and looks pretty good. The enclosure is made from plastic, but it gives a decent and quality impression. Size-wise, it's compact enough without feeling too cramped, and the weight of 1.37 kg confirms this device is very portable. The design is nice as well to my ID. Not too boring, yet still professional. And I like what they did with this bezel on top here. It provides space for the webcam without the need to increase the screen bezel overall and makes it nice to open up the laptop. In terms of connectivity, we have the following. On the left side, we can find a DC power input, a USB-A port, HDMI, a USB-C port, which can also be used to charge the laptop, and a 3.5mm headphones connector. On the front, there is nothing. And on the right side, we can find a power and drive activity LED, a tiny reset button, SD card reader, and another USB type A port. And on the back, just like on the front, there is nothing else to find either. Let's see how it is to work with a laptop now. Let's start with the touchpad. It feels smooth and responsive, and multi-touch works as you would expect for things like scrolling or gestures, and overall, there is never really a need to repeat actions, so this does a good job. I also saw that there are plenty of options available for 2, 3 and 4 finger gestures. The keyboard then, not much to say about it to be honest. It feels okay to type on, not the best, but nothing that would be disturbing too much either. Key travel is quite okay and the side of the keys is good. The top row of the keys functions both to change system settings, like the volume or brightness, and as F keys. The only minor downside that I would mention is about the cramped arrow keys, but again, nothing you can't live with or that's too disturbing. The webcam, which also has a handy privacy slider, is working surprisingly good. It manages to deal with difficult lighting situations in a very good way and delivers proper quality video. The 14-inch display does a good job as well. It has a Full HD resolution of 1920x1080 and that works well on this size of the display. It doesn't come close to something like a Mac Retina display, of course, but brightness is sufficient and the viewing angles are also okay. For the battery, the conclusion is similar. It comes with a 47 watt-hour capacity, but that allows the laptop to easily run for 4 to 5 hours without the need for charging. This is partly due to the energy efficiency of the CPU, which is only 15 watt TDP. So that might be slightly different with other CPUs in the same device. To charge that battery, you can use the 65 watt power supply with the barrel jack that comes with the laptop, or the good news is that you can also use that USB-C port on the left side to charge it, which might come in handy for sure. So far, things look quite good on this device in terms of build quality. And seeing these laptops aren't the most expensive, value for money is more than excellent. Before we get into benchmarking, let's take a quick look at the BIOS setup as well. We can enter it by repeatedly pressing F12 during boot. Then in the boot menu, choose for a setup. In here, we can see some information on the installed components. And other than that, it allows you to change some of the configuration as well. Back in Windows, let us start by having a look at about this PC. What we see here matches with what we saw on the BIOS setup and, As I mentioned in the beginning already, the version I have is equipped with an AMD Ryzen 5 7520U CPU. This one runs at 2.8 GHz and can boost up to 4.3 GHz. With a TDP of only 15 watts, as I mentioned, it's pretty energy efficient. So I'm curious to see if that won't backfire too much in the performance benchmarks like we saw before. The CPU also comes with integrated graphics, and seeing something like AMD Radeon 610M here sounds impressive, but I don't think the performance of that will come even remotely close to a dedicated GPU. But let's see what we can get, and I will start by running the CPU benchmark in Geekbench 5 first. The results are here. But only 813 single-core and 3166 multi-core isn't really what I expected. I saw this behavior before, and most likely it's due to the balanced battery scheme. Let me connect the device to power and give it another try. Okay, this is more of what I had in mind. 1058 single core and 4062 multi-core. Pretty decent performance, as we need to keep in mind that TDP of only 15 watt and the long battery life that comes with it. Let's also run the compute benchmark here, which should heavily rely on that integrated GPU. That won't really let you play any recent games, unfortunately. But that is kind of to be expected seeing the price of this laptop. Let me repeat all of this to see what scores we can get in Geekbench 6. For the CPU benchmark, we're getting 1387 single core and 4549 multi-core. Again, that's just an excellent score for this laptop if you ask me. For the compute benchmark, we're getting 4714 as a result, which, as we could also see in Geekbench 5 as well, performs similar to the integrated graphics of Intel CPUs, and it's far from fast. Now, let's take a look at this performance instead. The laptop is equipped with an NVMe SSD, so I'm curious to see if it can deliver the expected performance. 1145 MB per second write, and 1408 MB per second read. Far from the limits on what you could get out of NVMe, but way higher than what a SATA SSD would be able to do, and more importantly, proper performance for this kind of laptop. This won't slow you down for sure. As a last test, let's see how the Wi-Fi adapter performs. As we can see, the laptop is equipped with a MediaTek Wi-Fi 6 adapter, and I'm currently also connected to an 802.11ax, which is Wi-Fi 6, access point. By copying over a large file over the network, we can see that we get around 40 to even 50 megabytes per second over the wireless network here. So roughly 350 to 400 megabits per second, pretty much what you would expect. That was more or less all I have for the video. As a conclusion, I think you can say that this laptop delivers pretty decent performance for day-to-day home usage, at least if you don't plan to play any heavy games on it. The power consumption is pretty low, translating into decent battery life, and overall the build quality, feeling, and comfort to work with it is more than decent as well. Combine that with a relatively low price, and you're looking at great value for money on this laptop. Thanks a lot for watching. If you have liked this video, I'd appreciate a thumbs up, and if you like these kind of videos, make sure to subscribe to the channel. If you want to share your experience with this laptop or have some questions about it, be welcome in the comments. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.